My name is Martin, and I work at Eggs in Trondheim. So I don't sit here, but I work mostly with web development and also a bit of with iOS. So how many people know about Eggs from before? Is it not a lot of people? So Eggs is a design consult agency. Which is based here in Oslo and Trondheim, Stavanger, and also in Brazil. So we do a lot of design in both digital products and also physical products, as well as service design. But we're also doing a lot of development, and we're expanding quite heavily. So if you're interested in coming to work with us, we are looking for both web developers and iOS and Android developers. So come talk to me or any of the other Eggs people or check out our website. Cool. So I'm sure most of you heard about the Amazon incident that happened last week where half the internet almost broke down and services like Spotify and Quora and everything just shut down. It had some pretty big consequences, and it led to some pretty interesting situations like this. This poor guy with couldn't get into his home. So this was all because of a single typo. Somebody was going to shut down some servers, and they accidentally hit the wrong number, and they shut down the entire thing. And this just goes to show how fragile computers are. And that's because humans make mistakes all the time. Like, computers are great, but they do exactly what we tell them to do. And humans all the time makes mistakes. So that's sort of my transition into Elm. I think Elm is a great language that tries to sort of solve these issues by preventing us to make mistakes. Elm is a functional language that compiles down to JavaScript. So what I mean by that is that you write your code in a completely different language, which then compiles down to JavaScript, which the browser can understand. And by being functional, it's much more declarative, which means you tell the computer what you want to achieve instead of how exactly you want things to be done, which makes it much more robust, and you don't have the same problems you do with the imperative programming language. All right, so here's an example from a functional language called Haskell. This is an actual page on their Wikipedia. I'm not going to try to pronounce that, but a lot of functional languages can be quite hard to get into, and they introduce a lot of new concepts that, yeah, like this. Elm takes a quite a different approach. It's really focused on user experience, and the man behind Elm, Evan Chaplicki, he's put a lot of effort into making the language easy to learn and simple to get started with. So they sort of pulled away everything that's not essential, and you're left with a simple and easy to learn language. It's also very opinionated, so when you get started with Elm, everything is sort of decided before you even get started. Everything from how you structure your apps to what libraries you use and how you format your documentation, everything is sort of, the community has decided upon a best practice. So it's really easy to get started because you don't have to make a lot of decisions. And I think in the JavaScript community, we see a lot of like decision fatigue. People can't decide on which frameworks to use. This isn't really a problem in Elm because when you come here, everything is just decided on. Of course, you don't have to follow the rules, but it's really nice coming into a language where you don't have to spend half the project thinking about what frameworks you should use. All right, so let's compare a bit of JavaScript to some Elm code. So here we have a function in JavaScript adding two numbers. In Elm, this would look something like this. So you start off by defining your function name. So there's no parentheses, no semicolons. It's really simplistic. So you start with the function name, and then it's followed by the arguments. And then in Elm, you have an implicit return, so you don't have to type the return keyword. Everything, a function always has to return something. It's also very common to add a type signature. We'll get more into what this actually means and what types are in Elm, but you can sort of look at it as a way of defining how this function works. So it takes in two integers and it returns a new integer. This is how you would call a function in Elm. So again, it's just pretty much the same as JavaScript. It's just a bit more stripped down. This is an example of how you would write like probably the simplest language you can write in Elm that renders something on screen. So here we use the Elm HTML package, which is a package that comes along with the language. And it gives us the ability to render a text node with the text hello world. The main function here is what Elm will call when you initially start it up. So the Elm HTML package uses a virtual DOM, just like in React, where you have a virtual DOM that diffs your changes and then produces some output. It is super fast. It's actually much faster than both React and Angular, and it's also because it has the compiler, it can optimize at a different level, and you can get results that are just not possible in JavaScript. Like, for instance, they could, when WebAssembly is ready, try to compile directly down to that. So Elm is really performant. Here's how it would look if you're going to render a view like you would in React. Like, it's pretty similar to React. Like, it's just like JSX, only it's just Elm functions. So you have a view that returns a header. The header is just a function that takes in a list of attributes. So the attributes here are a class, and then it takes a list of child nodes. And it's pretty similar to how you would write code in React. The concept is the same, it's just a bit different syntax. A lot of people find the syntax a bit weird, like you have leading commas before before the different array attributes and stuff like that, but you'll get used to it and you might actually end up liking it. So in Elm, all functions are stateless. I think this is a concept that's getting really common in the React world, where you have stateless components. In Elm, that's pretty much, that's the only thing you can do. All functions in Elm are stateless. Which gives you a lot of benefits, like they're easier to test, they're easier to reason about, and you don't have any choice. Again, it comes back to being like an opinionated language, like you can't opt out of not having a stateless function or a view for that matter. So in JavaScript, for instance, we have side effects, and that's sort of how you can define if a function is stateless or not. Does it affect the outside world? And can it access the global scope? So if we look at our add function again, there's nothing stopping us from doing something like this, which at first seems to work just fine. But when you call it again, you get undefined is not a function, which is sort of, every JavaScript developer experienced this all over the time, and we're just used to how this is part of our workflow. Like, you wouldn't do something like the previous example, but it happens all the time. In Elm, you just can't get any runtime exceptions. Like, it is possible, but you really have to try hard. Like, you have to crash the program manually or just add an infinite loop or something. in practice, you will never get a runtime exception in Elm. And this is coming from JavaScript. This is a pretty cool feature of a language. And this is sort of boils down to being like Elm is all about giving you the guarantees you need. Like the language is sort of designed to give you all your like all the guarantees you need to make sure your program works the way you want it to, and it's not going to crash at runtime, and you have to fix all the track down all different kinds of bugs and etc. One of these, like the way it does this, is by making like in Elm all data is immutable, which also makes it a lot easier to reason about, and you can sort of know that nobody's going to come in and change the data without you sort of knowing it. And if you look at some data structures in Elm, this is called a record type. We can define a point which contains an X and Y value. So record type is just like an object in JavaScript. Only much simpler, you don't have all the properties that you do in a JavaScript object. If you ever want to update this object or record, we can define a function like this, which takes in a point and returns an updated version. And this will actually return a completely new record. It will not mutate the current record. So here we just set the X value without sort of updating the Y value, but that's still sort of passed along, just like you would use the spread operator in JavaScript. Elm also has a statically typed type system, which is really, really powerful. It will look through all your code and make sure that wherever you're using a value, it matches up with what you're trying to do. And it will guarantee that whatever you're trying to do is working the way it should. It can also infer your types for you, so you don't have to explicitly write out the types you're using. Like the type signature we saw before, you don't have to write that. The Elm compiler can sort of figure that out for you. All right, so if we look at our points again, this is how it will look if we added some type signatures. So here we have the type signature for our point. It's a record with two values, both are integers. But as you can see, this is pretty tedious to write out all the time. When you pass this along, it sort of gets a bit tedious. So we can define something called a type alias. So we sort of give that type signature a name. So every time we reference a point, it's really saying that we're trying to reference that record with the two integers. And then we can replace that in our code base. And as you can see, it's much easier to read. And we don't have all these huge records to look at. So the compiler will actually guide you as you programming in Elm. And this is something that's really, sorry about the 80s stock photos. It's a really nice Tumblr blog. All right, so yeah, the compiler will sort of guide you as you program, and it will try to help you instead of just yelling at you. And this sort of comes down to its error messages, which are super friendly. I've never sort of seen a compiler that so is that friendly. It's usually just saying some, exactly, yeah. So if you look at an example, like let's say we're building a to-do app and we define a view for our task item. So here's just a view that renders a list element with a text node for the task name. And then we define a view for our list, which is just a UL element. And then we map over the task view, or we map over the tasks into the task view. But as you can see, we have a typo in our list.nap. So if we try to run this through the compiler will give us an error. So it says naming error, cannot find variable list.nap. List does not expose nap. Maybe you want one of the following. And it actually suggests some alternatives that we might try to use. So it actually tries to help you, and it even highlights exactly, not just the line number, but exactly where the error is. So all right, if we fix this, we might want to render this on screen. So we define our main function, and we pass in our list view with a list of tasks. But here as well, we passed in a name equals 0 instead of a string, which is what it's expecting. So if we run this through the compiler, it says that the function list view is expecting the argument to be list of or a task of string, but it is a number. And it even gives us a hint to like how you should proceed to debug this. So it's, again, it's really focusing on trying to help you instead of yelling at you. In Elm, there's also no concept of null or undefined. So it's just, it's not part of the language, which is also an sort of interesting approach. Like, we're so used to having null and undefined, at least coming from more traditional programming languages. This is usually just like a natural part. Things can still fail. Like, it's not like things can't fail in Elm, or things can't be like the equivalent of null. So we need to have some way of expressing that same property. And to understand that, we need to look at something called union types. So a union type is a way of expressing your data in a much more natural way. So instead of using like booleans and strings and nulls, which we often use in more traditional programming languages, to express our data, we can use union types to present the data in a much more natural way. So the easiest example could be something like this, where you have like a compass point, which can either be north, south, east, or west. And it can be either one of these values, but not many or like multiple at the same time. So it's just like an enum, but it's a bit more powerful because you can also have values associated to it. So if you want to define a user that can either be anonymous or it has a name, we could do it like this. So instead of having like a property with a Boolean called hasName or something like this, we can define a user that is either anonymous or it's a named user, and then it has a string associated to it. So it's really powerful. And we can use this to sort of express the concept of null without introducing null itself, by introducing what in Elm is called maybe. So the maybe type is either just a value or it's nothing. So it can be either of these two things. And the A here is like a placeholder for a different kind of type. So it could be a string or an int or even a user. Like, it could be anything. It's just a placeholder for another type. And this is really powerful. So we can, in our task example, like, we could define a type alias for our task, which has a name, but we also want to have a description. But that description is optional, so you don't have to write a description. We could define a type alias like this, where the description is a type of maybe string instead of just string. So we can either have a description or it can be nothing. And if we write a view to render this description, we could pass in the task, and we can pattern match on that description value. So this is sort of like a switch statement in JavaScript. The case task description of, and if it's just the description, we just return that description. So we can sort of unbox that value from the maybe type. So if we run this through the compiler, we will actually get an error. So the case does not have branches for all possibilities. You need to account for the following values, maybe dot nothing. And this is quite important because the compiler will actually force us to add a branch for all the possibilities. So there's no way you can forget to handle the case where a user didn't type in the description. You're forced by the compiler to return some value. Like, you could return like an empty string if you wanted to, but you have to explicitly define what the computer should do if there's no value entered. And this is sort of what makes Elm so, I think it's so, you can refactor code with a lot of confidence because the compiler will always tell you if you're sort of missing anything. It's not just like the maybe type. It's with, like, if you get a response from a server and you're not handling that error, it will tell you in a friendly way. It also has a great package manager, which is also about giving you guarantees when you write your applications. Oh. It can look at the type signatures of your functions and then see how your code changed. And it can even enforce semantic versioning. So if you try to publish a package where you change the type signature of any of the functions you're exposing, it will actually look at the code and see, like, hey, you have to upgrade this to a major version because this is a breaking change. So if you try to publish a package that breaks your API, you're not allowed to do it. And this is also, like, we see time to time in JavaScript using NPM that it can be a bit fragile. But with Elm, you sort of have the guarantees, as you have in the language itself as well, that nothing is going to break without you knowing about it. So in Elm, you structure your applications through something called the Elm Architecture. This is, you don't have to do it this way, but again, it comes back to being like opinionated. It's sort of considered the best practice in the community. It's quite simple. It consists of three parts. It's the model, view, and update. So if we look at an example, we have, you start off by defining the model. So the model is just a representation of your entire application state. So for instance, with our task example, you would define all your tasks in this model. And then you define a view function, which just takes in that model and renders some HTML based upon the current state of your application. Then you define a update function. So when you do something in the application, it will trigger the update function, which takes in a message and then returns a new state. And then that will, again, update the model and render the view with the updated state. So this is pretty much exactly the same as Redux, where you have like your entire application state in one place and you have reducers that work on that data and then renders your views. So I think this is pretty common in the React community as well, but it is a really interesting way of structuring your app. And in Elm, everything is just a function, so things compose this really well. You don't have the concept of components. It's just a bunch of reusable functions. So if you look at an example of how we can build this, if we were to build a counter application, we start off by defining a type alias for our model. Our model just consists of a count. We then define some messages, so the actions that this application can execute are either an increment or a decrement message or an action. We then define an update function. This is just like a reducer in Redux. We take in a message, the old model, and then we return a new model. And then we pattern match on that message. If it's a increment, we take the current model and add one to that count and return a new model. If it's a decrement, we just subtract it. And then we just need to define a view. Our view can take in a function, a model, and return some HTML. Here we just return a div with two buttons and a text node that renders the current model state. Our two buttons have an onClick attribute, which will fire off the messages that they have defined into our update function, which will again trigger the render. So this is how you would structure your applications in Elm. The cool thing about Elm is that everybody does this, so it's not like you're getting into a new code base and somebody's using a completely different framework. And as your app starts to grow, you can sort of split this out into separate modules with their own little update model view patterns, and you can sort of nest these as much as you want. And since it's just reusable components, it's really easy to compose them in the way you want to. All right, so I thought since this is a React meetup, it would be nice to look at some of the things we can learn from Elm and what we can try to bring back into our own code base, because I don't think Elm is gonna take over the world just yet. Hopefully it will be the language that everybody's using in the future, but I think for now it's more likely that we'll still program in JavaScript or something similar. We'll see, but I think there's a lot we can learn and pull into our JavaScript code base. And I think the biggest thing I would recommend is introducing some static typing. I think we have really two options to choose from if we were to apply it to our current JavaScript code base, which is Flow and TypeScript. So Flow is made by Facebook and is pretty heavily developed or used in the React community. It's a really powerful type system, but I think it's also a problem and a benefit, but Flow is a gradual type system, so you can apply it as you move along. You don't have to sort of opt into using it for all your code. But with TypeScript, it's more like an all or nothing. You can apply it one file at a time, but still, if you change your file to a TypeScript file, the compiler will complain at you if you do something that the compiler doesn't like. And so coming from the Elm side, I think I kind of like that approach, that it forces you to do things correctly. You can't opt out of using it, but it all just depends on the project and how reliable does it have to be. Is it super crucial that every type matches up? Then you should use TypeScript. If you just want to apply some types to your code base that have some critical parts in it, maybe Flow is a better choice. But if you're using TypeScript, you should definitely enable strict null checks. This is something that was added in TypeScript 2.0, which means that they actually differentiate null from other values. So previously, you could say that a function takes in a string, but you could always pass in null. It didn't actually differentiate between null and string. But if you enable strict null checks, the compiler will actually complain at you if you try to use null in your functions. So I want to just finish up with a quick example of how we could add some types to our Redux code. So in TypeScript, we can define two types for our messages or actions. Here we have an add to do and a toggle to do. We can define an action type, which is either a to do or a toggle to do. And again, this is really similar to what we have in Elm. We can define a reducer, which takes in a state, and an action and returns a new state. And then if we switch on the action type, we can sort of handle each action. And this is pretty like common Redux code, but the cool thing is that if we pass this through the TypeScript compiler, we'll get an error because we have a typo. So you can see the type addToD is not comparable to type addToDo or toggleToDo. So the compiler will actually yell at us if we make a mistake in, or like a typo in our reducers. And this is really cool. It's sort of getting into the same aspect of Elm where you have guarantees that your code will do exactly what you tell it to do. And also if we add a new type, show completed, add that to our action type, if we now run this through the compiler without adding a case for that type, we'll get an error, which looks like this. It's not the most pretty error. It sort of tries to tell us that we haven't handled all possible branches. And there are ways of getting a better error message, but still it's an error message, which will sort of give us a hint that you haven't handled this action. If we compare this to like the Elm error message, you can see that it's quite different. It's not as friendly, but still it's something. It's a good start, I think. But I would highly recommend checking out Elm more, because I think we can learn a lot from it, even though you're not going to use it at work. It might be nice to just experiment with it to get to know the type system and some of the features in Elm. So elmlang.org is a really nice website. They have a lot of great tutorials and guides that I would recommend reading, because they just introduce you to so many new concepts it's really a helpful resource. Also, I had a meetup in Trondheim a couple of weeks ago where we made Pong. There's if you go to the eggs GitHub, you can find the Elm meetup repo where it's a tutorial where you can go through and implement Pong. Also, I want to recommend, if you're here in Oslo, to check out the Elm meetup. I haven't been to it myself since I'm based in Trondheim, but I heard it's a great meetup, and I would recommend checking that out. All right, that was it. Any questions? Yeah?
Why aren't you using this in production? Or why do we never hear people talking?
Well, there are some people using it. That's a good question. I think it's going to get more common. But right now, it's a bit hard, especially for us as a consultancy, to sort of convince the client to use this weird little language that nobody else is using, and then sort of have to find developers that can programming in Elm. But I think it's going to get more common, and it's really easy to integrate it sort of bits by bits. So you don't have to rewrite everything in Elm. You can write a little module that's only in Elm. Maybe your business logic is really crucial that it doesn't break. So you can rewrite that and get the guarantees that you have with the Elm compiler. So, yeah. I've used it a bit for clients, but only tiny pieces like simulators and stuff that's a bit outside of the code base.
How easy is it to integrate with the rest of the code base? How can you make an NPM module that you can distribute to people, and would that be humongous, or would it be compiled out to
you can definitely do that. You have to have the Elm compiler, so I guess you could compile it and then distribute everything. That would be fine, and it shouldn't be that big. Elm doesn't do any tree shaking or something like that, so it has a runtime that I don't know how big it is, but maybe like 40 kilobytes, so it's not like a big issue. But yeah, you can definitely do that, and it's really easy to just add it to parts of your application. The only sort of if you're doing stuff that's speaking a lot to native JavaScript, Elm is really strict about that. So you can't just ask if you're integrating with Google Maps, for instance. It's not as easy to just hook into that. You have to write specific ports that it speaks through. So it depends on your use case as well.
All right. Can you step through the code?
What's that?
Can you step through the code?
You mean like breakpoints? Mm-hmm. No, I don't think so. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure.
But
I haven't seen that.
You have a time traveling debugger.
That's true. You have a time traveling debugger. So you can. So every time you, because of this Elm architecture stuff, you dispatch an action, and that sort of updates the model. So you can go back in time and see how your code changes. Mm-hmm. So you can sort of inspect how your application develops over time.
You can see all the events that come through your update loop and kind of keep track of what's going on there.
Yeah.
So you don't really need to step through manually because you can see a particular state, and because everything is immutable. Mm. Given a particular model, then you can load to the exact state it was at. So you can just take that model and then figure out what went wrong.
Yeah, the only thing which is a bit difficult if you want to like figure out the type of something inside your function, like not related to your model, but you want to inspect something inside the model, like you could with a breakpoint. It's a bit tough. Like you would have to force it to crash, and it would give you a compile error, and you could sort of.
Yeah. Or you can just use debug.log, which
yeah.
Just print it out to the console.log.
But I'm sure that's something that's gonna get better over time as well. Mm-hmm. Cool. All right.
10 minutes.
Yep.
Yep.
Cool.